the 14th chapter and verse 14. Job, in the midst of his suffering, is asking questions and really questioning things in his relationship with God. He asked the question, if a man die, shall he live again? In this 14th chapter, he speaks a number of times. He comes to this point of death and not knowing for sure what lies ahead of him regarding that relationship. Chapter 14 and verse 1, man born of woman is a few days and full of trouble. He cometh forth like a flower and is cut down. He fleeth like a shadow and continueth not. Will God open his eyes to such a one as he? Will he bring me into judgment with him? I like to talk to him. I like to discuss things with him. I like to discuss what's right or wrong. But would he look upon someone that's so insignificant? Probably not. So I began to realize that that's not probably something that we realize. But when I die, I realize how insignificant I am. And he continues on by thinking, there's really more hope for a tree than me. A tree is cut down and it has hope of blossoming again. Notice Job says this, for there is hope of a tree. If he be cut down, he will sprout again. It just gets the scent of water and it buds. But I die. I'm laid low, verse 10. Yea, man giveth up the ghost. Where is he? I'm saying, where'd he go? Gave up the ghost, where'd he go? And in verse 12, so the man lieth down and riseth not till heavens be no more. They shall not awake, nor shall they be aroused, or be roused from sleep. If the man dies, shall he live again? And Job says, I would spend all of my days of warfare waiting for my release. The word release there denotes renewal. It denotes change. If I knew I was going to rise from the dead because I'm dying and I'm going to give up the ghost, don't know where I am, that's where I'm going to be laid low. If I knew that man would rise again, then I would just go through my warfare, not only what I'm going through now, going through Sheol, knowing I'll rise again. I would wait for my change and for my renewal. Job is asking questions, and Jesus answered it. Jesus says in John 11, 25, I am the resurrection and the life. And no one, as he says, no one comes to the Father but by me in John 14, 6. And he says, he that believeth on me, that's going to come to the Father through him. He that believeth on me, though he die, Job, yet shall he live. Jesus answers it, doesn't he? And through Jesus Christ and the writings of the gospel, we can go through our warfare. We can go through Sheol as we wait for the glories of heaven. And I would like to look at God's word with you this morning. It ought to give us hope. It'll tell us where our hope lies. It'll tell us what happens when we die and what it means to be dead. I want to hit that at the beginning. If a man dies, let me tell you what's dead. His body is dead. See, death is a separation. We're not going to talk about the spirit, not going to talk about the soul right now. You didn't leave existence. But what the Bible says, when you die, tell me what's dead. James 2:26, in a great imagery to help us understand about saving or productive faith. It says, for as the body apart from the spirit is dead. Spirit departs, body's dead. Even so, faith apart from works is dead. So I can profess I know Christ, but if I don't work in obedience, I don't have faith. Just like my body is dead. And there's so many ways in the New Testament to establish that. What's buried? My soul's not buried. We bury a body. When John the Baptist died, disciples came and took up the corpse, the Bible says, in Matthew 14, 12, and buried it. Took the corpse. That's not your soul. It's not your spirit. It's your body. When Jesus died, Joseph wrapped him in clean linen. Wrapped his what? Soul? That's departed. Wrapped his body with clean linen. So when I think about death, my mind says, the body is dead. The body is dead. And may I say, it is body sleep, not soul sleep. But we're asleep when we die. What is that perspective from? When you look at the casket and you see the loved one, do you see the spirit? Do you see the soul? No, we know that's left. What do we see? All the imagery comes. He's asleep. She's asleep. In 1 Thessalonians, the 4th chapter, verses 13 through 18, Mason read so well, he says, we'll not have you ignorant concerning them that fall asleep. From what perspective? The body. See, God has an emphasis on the body that sometimes we don't think about. We just buried it. We think about our soul. He said, I got a great emphasis on the body. And from the perspective of looking at the body, you've fallen asleep. It's not like some say, well, you just quit thinking and soul sleep. No, the body is sleeping. For if we believe that Jesus Christ died and rose again, even so them also that are fallen asleep in Jesus. When we put the body to rest, the eyes are closed. It looks like you sleep. What relationship were they in? They were in Christ. And that's what gives the Christian hope. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we that are alive, that are left unto the coming of the Lord, shall in no wise precede them that have fallen asleep. Now look at verse 16. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Oh, we're not dead. We depart from the spirit. We're alive. No, you're dead. We're dead. That's what he says. Because the dead, they have fallen asleep in Christ. The dead shall rise first. The dead in Christ? I thought we were alive in Christ. No, you're dead in Christ from the perspective of the body. And God says, pay attention to the body. And I am. We see our loved ones asleep. But they were asleep in Jesus. And if he came back today, we that are alive are going to step aside because the dead are going to be raised first. And then we're going to be caught up with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. So when you think about asleep in Jesus, what do you think about? I'm thinking about the body. And I realize that when I die, I'm dead. It is the body that's raised. Not my soul, not my spirit. It's the body that is raised. When the veil in the temple at the crucifixion of Jesus rent from the top to the bottom, so no man got up there and did that. God did that. Way into the holy place is open. So the imagery is there. The tombs were opened. And those saints who had died were raised. They didn't come forth from the tomb and go into the city until after the resurrection of Jesus. What was raised? What was laid in that tomb? Well, that wasn't your soul. That wasn't your spirit. You're separated. It was the body. My body is dead when I die. And Jesus rose from the what? He arose from the dead. What arose? His body. Because when they went in Luke 24 and verse 3 to look into the tomb where they knew they had buried him and his body was there, the body was not there. And yet Jesus on that Lord's day would make himself known to his disciples, to his apostles, and he would show them the nail prints in his hand, the gashes in his side. That was the body that was crucified. That's the body that's raised. Until then, Jesus was dead. We sometimes think, well, my loved one's not dead. Yeah, they are. And they're asleep from the standpoint of the body. And will he live again? Yeah, he'll live again. But he's going to remain dead until he's raised from the dead. That's when he will live. And talk about existence. I talk about being dead. I ask you to turn to 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, and verses 20 through 25, because we know Christ has been raised. Note, the first fruits of them that are asleep. What's raised? The body. It is laid low. It's asleep. And because Christ had been raised, then we're going to be raised. But here's the order in which things happen. The first fruits, Christ is the first fruits of them that are asleep. We understand now that's being dead. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. What's raised? The body. For as in Adam all die, also in Christ shall all be made alive, but each in his own order. Christ, the first fruits. Yes, we've just seen that. His body was dead. His body is dead without the spirit. Spirit's reunited with the body. He's raised from the dead. Sends to heaven. He's the first fruits. That means there's going to be a harvest, and I'm going to be part of the harvest. And you are too. Each in his own order. Christ, the first fruits. Then they that are Christ, when? At your funeral. You're dead, and you'll remain dead. Till when? Then they that are Christ at his coming. In Christ, verse 22, shall all be made alive. I thought they're already alive. They're with Jesus. Is that what the Bible teaches? When will you be made alive? When Jesus comes back again. Not any sooner. And you think about that passage. I know, because it's the body that's going to be raised. It wasn't soul sleep. It was body sleep. So we just kind of get a hold of that. The body's dead. I'm dead. Because my body is dead. And here is how it's going to work. Christ blazed the trail. He is the first fruits of a harvest. His body was raised. My body is going to be raised. He was dead when he's in the tomb. I'm going to be dead in the grave. And I won't be made alive until Jesus comes. That's the concept the Apostle Paul wants us to have. What happens then? That's when death will be abolished. Verse 24, then cometh the end, when he shall deliver up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall abolish all rule and all authority and all power. For he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet, and the last enemy that shall be abolished is death. He's reigning while death is still occurring, while people are dying and they stay dead until the body is raised. That's when Jesus comes back again. Not a moment sooner. That's when those who are dead in Christ shall be made alive. Till then, that body's sleeping. It's deteriorating. But we know when he comes back again, death will be abolished and everybody will be raised. In John 5, 28 and 29, the voice of Jesus should be listened to now. But he says, one day, you're not going to avoid it. Because the hour cometh, in verse 28, when all that are in the tombs shall hear his voice. The bodies are subject to the commanding voice of the Lord. All the tombs, all the dead that are in the tombs shall hear his voice and shall come forth. They that have done good unto resurrection of life, that they that have done evil, they're going to be raised, aren't they? The resurrection of judgment, condemnation. That's not living. That's existing. Separated from God. Eternal death. But everybody will be raised. Paul, by the time Paul comes along, the Jews, especially the Pharisees, had a concept of the resurrection of everyone. They called it the resurrection of the just and the unjust. He believed that. And Jews believe that. Christ establishes. The hour is not what there's going to be a resurrection of the good. They've done good. And then a little bit later on, thousands of years later, there'll be another resurrection. The hour is coming when both are raised at the same time. The just and the unjust will be raised. All in the tombs. All in our graveyards. All over the world. Shall hear the commanding voice of the Lord, and their bodies will be raised that have been asleep. And that's when we will be made alive. When our spirits connected with this glorified body. If one is righteous, he or she will remain in the realm of the dead till they're resurrected when the Lord comes again. I give up the ghost. Where do I go? Where did Jesus go? Acts 2:47, Jesus, as Peter speaks, so is what Jesus, it would not leave my soul in Hades. Neither will thou leave thy Holy One to see corruption. That's the grave. He's raised on the third day. But where's his soul? Heaven? We'd like to think that. What's the truth? Well, I'm looking at Jesus. Where did you go? Where did your spirit go when your body is in the tomb? Went to Hades. That's the unseen, that's not hell. That's the unseen place for departed spirits. Luke 23:34, when Jesus on the cross said, one of those malefactors, murderers, thieves, speaking to Jesus, remember me when you come in your kingdom. Today, Jesus says, you'll be with me in paradise. In the Hadean world, there's this beautiful garden. That's the idea of paradise. Not that it's literal, but it's the idea of a beautiful, pleasant place to be. And it's called Hades, not heaven. And the one who wrote that psalm is David. In Psalm 16 and verse 19, he's the one that's writing it and pointing to someone beyond himself. And we know from Acts 2, 34 and 35, David did not ascend into heaven. What? Any a man after God's own heart, when he dies, he ought to go to heaven. He didn't. He didn't. He did not ascend to heaven, but he's talking about Jesus who did. And of all things, he quotes from Psalm 110, Lord, put all things under his feet. And we know the last enemy that will be defeated is death when Jesus comes back again. That's not David, that's Jesus. I know David didn't go to heaven either. Jesus didn't go straight to heaven when he died. We go to the place of departed spirits, and Paul knows that. He takes us on this journey. In 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, verses 1 through 5, this earthly tabernacle, this body is being decayed, it's being struck down, and we're experiencing death. He says earlier in the 4th chapter, the latter part of that, his inward man is being renewed day by day as his outward man is decaying. We know this body is going to be struck down. This earthly house of our tabernacle will be struck down. But we have something waiting for us in the future, a building from God, not made with hands. Reserved where? In heaven. It's reserved for us in heaven. It's eternal in the heavens. And that's what he expresses here. Notice in verse 2. I'll read verses 2 through 4. For verily in this we groan, longing to be clothed upon with our habitation, which is from heaven. If so that being clothed, we shall not be found naked. Why did you bring that up, Paul? Because we're unclothed. We don't have a body in the Hadean world. We're naked. We don't have a body. For indeed we are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not that we should be unclothed, but what we be clothed upon, that what is mortal may be swallowed up of life. Question. When will this mortal be swallowed up with life? When? When I die and I go to heaven? Let Paul answer that in the 15th chapter of 1 Corinthians. When he says in verse 52, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, the dead shall be raised incorruptible. See, dead. You know what's dead, don't you? The body. And it's going to be at the resurrection. When Christ comes, the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we, if we're alive at that time, shall be changed. For this corruption must put on incorruption, this mortal must put on immortality, deathlessness. And when this corruptible shall I put on incorruption, and this mortal shall I put on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Yeah, but I went to heaven anyway. If you went to heaven, you're there dead. You're dead in heaven. My body's dead. Spirits in the Hadean world. And Paul says, I don't want to remain naked. I don't want to be unclothed. What do you want to be clothed with? I want to be this mortal. I want to be swallowed up of life. How about immortality? Yeah, that's what I want. When are you going to get that? Not right after my funeral. And everybody comforts one another, says she's in heaven. Is she? Is he? If they are, they're dead. Because they will not be made alive again until the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the key to that is understanding God puts a lot more emphasis on this body than sometimes we do. We just bury it and we move on. Oh, it's still asleep. And God is not finished with his great plan. Jesus went to Hadean world. David is still there. Because I know he didn't ascend to heaven. Paul says, I don't want to stay there. I'm waiting for immortality. Waiting for the Lord to come again. But in 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 8, Paul says that while we're home in this body, we're separated from the Lord. For we walk by faith and not by sight. We're of good courage, and I say, are willing rather to be absent from the body and be home with the Lord. Yeah. That's what he's longing for. And the question is, when? Well, when you depart from the body. Didn't Paul say in Philippians 1:23 that he was in a strait betwixt the two? Wondering if should I stay in the body? I'd be more needful for my brethren. Or to leave this body and to be at home with the Lord. Leave the body, be home. I've died and I'm going to heaven. Be at home with Christ. Be at home with the Lord. Being with Christ. Where's Christ? He's in heaven. So you might get the concept, well, we just go there. Jesus didn't. David didn't. What do you think you do? I can be in the Hadean world still looking forward to being at home with the Lord. Is it necessarily true that I just leave the body and I go straight to heaven and be with the Lord where Jesus is? Maybe. But why do you say that? Because everything else we've looked so far says no. Maybe this will be helpful in Hebrews 9:28 when we see verse 27. Insomuch as is appointed unto man once to die, and after this cometh judgment. When I die, do I go straight to the judgment? Well, my life has already determined where I'm going to be, but what judgment is he talking about? So Christ also, having been once offered to bear the sins of many, shall appear a second time apart from sin unto them that wait for him unto salvation. It's his second coming. Oh, that fits. That's when mortal will be clothed with immortality. That's when death will be no more. That's when the dead in Christ shall be made alive. All of that makes sense to me. Why do we put an immediate pause? I'll go for this body. I want to be with the Lord. When it could be, Paul said, I don't want to stay in this unclothed condition. I want to be home with the Lord. When will it happen? David, how long have you been in the grave? Asleep. And your spirit has been in the Hadean world because you know you're not in heaven. I'm waiting. I'm waiting for the Lord to return. And do you know the Bible tells us very plainly when we're going to be home with the Lord? We just read it in 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 through 18. The dead in Christ shall rise first. That's when they will be made alive. And then we are alive. What's going to happen? We'll be changed in a moment, a twinkle of an eye, into that glorified body. And then we'll meet the Lord in the air and ever be with the Lord. That's when we're going to be with the Lord. And Paul could be saying, which I think he does, I want to leave the body. It's far better, Paul said, Philippians, for me to be with Christ. That's true. But that's going to be a while. And to say that we go straight to heaven, I ask you, where do we get that from Scripture? I think we get it a lot from Paul's sayings. I'm saying, Hebrews 9:28, do we die and then we already gone through the judgment? No, he'll appear a second time. And it won't be judgment for us, it'll be us going to heaven. If that's true, then those who have died in the Lord are still filled with hope. And I ask you, hope for what? I'm already with Jesus. You're dead. You're naked if you are. You have not completed the road that God says we're going to go through, because I care about that body issue. I'm going to raise that body. That's when you'll be glorified. Notice in Romans, the 8th chapter, in verse 24 and 25. Who hope for that which he seeth? But hope is centered on things that we see not, that we have not experienced yet. And so, Apostle Paul makes this statement, for in hope were we saved. But hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopeth that which he seeth? But if we hope for that which we see not, then we do with patience wait for it. When Paul says, all things work together for good to them that love God, Romans 8, 29 and 30, what's one of the things that's part of God's eternal plan? From his foreknowledge and foreordination, we're going to be like Christ, he's going to be our firstborn, called by the gospel, justified, and we are what? Glorified. Glorified. When will we be glorified? Well, I went straight to heaven. That's pretty glory for me. When will we be glorified? And Paul stresses this earlier in the chapter when he says in verses 17 and 18, if children, then heirs of God. And he says, and joint heirs with Christ. It shall be that we suffer with him, we shall also be glorified with him. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed to us. Word. Yeah, we're going straight to heaven. I'm going to be with Jesus, and that's my glory. No. I'm waiting to be glorified with the glorified body that Jesus makes after the pattern of his glorified body. Philippians 3, 20-21. We wait for a Savior from heaven. He's coming apart from sin the second time. That's what I'm waiting on. And what he's doing, he's going to transform my body of humiliation that's deteriorating and dying. It's been asleep since the funeral. He's going to mold that body and change it in the image of his own body. It'd be conformed to the body of his what? Glory. According to the working whereby he's to subject all things unto himself. I can be in the Hadean world filled with hope, because I am knowing that I have a home in heaven waiting, and it's going to be a glorified existence. And yes, I can be comforted in Abraham's bosom. No, you're not a Jew. You know that Luke 16 parable that talked about Lazarus, that rich man? And God doesn't speak in that parable. It's just Abraham. That's for Jewish people. No, it's for you and me, dear Christian. And wonder if we do not go straight to heaven, but we go to Abraham's bosom. Are you disappointed? Not me. Because I know, as we see in Luke the 16th chapter, in 23 and 25, that when Lazarus died, the angels came and took him to Abraham's bosom. And the rich man that looks beyond that great expanse that he could not get to and Lazarus could not get to him. He sees him in Abraham's bosom. That's a place of comfort. Bosom comfort. In verses 23 and 25, he can look over there and realize, I am tormented. I'm feeling something. He reasons. Didn't have a body. That body was buried. But he's reasoning because his soul, his spirit's intact. And he can remember he's got five brethren. He could feel, I don't want them to come here. He could reason, I don't want them to come here. I'm in pain, but he's over here in comfort. Abraham said so. He's now comforted, and you are being tormented. We feel, we reason, we know. I'm saying we can hope, because I'm not glorified yet. I don't want to remain unclothed. I want to be changed into immortality, because God, that's your final abolishment of death. I want to experience that. You know what? Being in Abraham's bosom is just fine with me, because I know I'm in the right place. Galatians, the third chapter, verses 28 and 29, we see the picture of the Christian. If you are in Christ, verse 29, you are Abraham's seed. Well, why wouldn't I want to be in the bosom of Abraham? I've got it. That's a great eternal plan. I'm in Abraham's bosom. I'm Abraham's seed. I'm heirs according to promise. And I'm still waiting. I'm still hoping. I'm still expecting. Oh God, my body's still asleep. I want to be alive. And when you come back again, you go on to unite these spirits with this dead, sleeping body. It's going to be changed. Swallowed up of life, be immortal. And that's when I'm going to meet the Lord. I'm going to meet him in the air. We're going to heaven together. And I'll ever be with the Lord. That's eternity. If we go straight to heaven when we die, and we look at Paul's words as we did that, we are there in heaven dead. That's Bible. That's the truth. Because we're not united with our body. God says death is not going to destroy this body that I created for you. I'm raising it. Jesus was the first fruits. He went to Hades. He was raised from the dead. His body was raised from the dead. He is sitting into heaven. And we can be where he is one day in a glorified state, seeing him as he is. Until then, knowing how pure that is. I want to purify myself right now. I want to make sure that when they lay my body low, I know I'll live again, but I will not live again until I'm raised from the dead. Didn't Stephen look up into heaven? God allowed him to see Jesus. Jesus wasn't sitting. He was standing. Like he's ready to do something. And Stephen said, Lord, receive my spirit. Receive my spirit. Sound like he went right to heaven. No. Could it be that God says, I've received it. Now, angels, come get him. And take him to Abraham's bosom. Like you did Lazarus. And all the redeemed will be waiting for that hope of glory. I trust that we will be built up to know what happens when we die, knowing that's not the end of us. But Paul says in 2 Timothy 4:8, I've finished the course, I've kept the faith. He fought that good fight as he had finished that course and he remained faithful. Henceforth, there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness. When are you going to get that, Paul? You mean you're up there with Jesus and you're dead and you don't have a crown yet? That's heaven? No, I don't want to stay in this state. I want to be home with the Lord. And I want to be glorified. And that's why he says, the crown of life which the righteous judge will give to me on that day. Don't have it yet, on that day. And all those that love his appearing will all rejoice together with that. Everybody's going to get the crown of victory. But when is victory taking place? It's when Jesus comes back again and doesn't raise up our spirits. He's already done that with his promise. He raises those bodies and said, now I've got the body that's a glorified body with this spirit and this soul that served God all their days. They're united in the Lord. I'm ready. I'm ready. I've been ready to go to heaven. I trust that we will so live. And Job, yes, you will live again. You'll live again when Jesus comes back again to raise you from the dead. And we'll all be there with you. David, Paul, and Job will be there together. May we so live, longing for that moment of glorification. If a man die, shall he live again? We sing, yes, he is. He will live. Spirit doesn't go out of existence. It's in a place of comfort if you serve the Lord. Wouldn't it be a great thing to live a life that you know that when death occurs, and it will happen to all of us, that our spirit is separated, that we can be in a place of comfort instead of a place of torment, waiting for the final judgment? You can. You can follow the teachings of the gospel, and you can have your soul redeemed, and then start living out that redemption through your body that you have, knowing one day that it'll be dissolved, it'll be struck down, but you're going to be clothed one day with immortality because you serve the Lord. You'll be raised with the just, and you'll be raised with them that did good unto life. And that's when we'll come alive. But we may have to wait a long time for that to occur. Or he may come right now. And that's why I want you to be prepared. Come to Jesus and obey his gospel while you have this opportunity. Come as we stand and sing.